All right. Yesterday, good morning. Good morning, everyone. Yesterday, we began to understand a little bit what we can understand about the commandment of the red cow. Even though the commandment of the red cow, it says, is called a chuk, it's totally not understandable. But on the other hand, there's a commandment to try to understand as much as possible about Judaism. And even though this commandment of the red cow, it demonstrates better than any other the commandments the fact that they come from God, and it's totally ridiculous to even think consider that you would understand God. It's like trying to grab ideas of mathematics with a bag or something. It's just your mind is just not the proper vessel to grasp God. But what your heart is, the heart can grasp. But on the other hand, everything that is possible to understand about this red cow, the external parts, let's say, we have to try to understand. No, we have to try to understand. Just like, I mean, it's not that far, but just like life, you can't understand what life is. But you can understand a lot of aspects about life. What makes people happy? What motivates people? What people are afraid of? What people like? There's aspects of life. What people understand? What people philosophies in life? Right? That's ideally what's supposed to universities are for, to improve life, to make. But what life is itself, nobody can possibly know. It's impossible. It's a gift. Nobody knows where it comes from. Nobody knows where it goes to. No one can't understand who's giving it to us, or is someone, maybe it's just this process. There's all these theories, what they are, but still it remains a big mystery. How much more so the giver of life, God, and his commandments. His commandments are his will, the will of God. Doesn't make any sense, but it's true. That's what Judaism is. And just to prove it, God appeared on Mount Sinai and spoke to all the Jews. And just to show you how incomprehensible it is, at Mount Sinai, God revealed himself. The Jews saw him face to face. He spoke to them. It says their souls jumped out of their bodies, thereby proving without a doubt that God exists and his Torah is true. And the Jews should only worship him. And 40 days later, all of the Jews participated in doing exactly what God said not to do, worshiping the golden calf. So we see how incomprehensible God is. I mean, that story just makes no sense. So, I mean, if the police would appear to you and you knew that they were watching, they had surveillance cameras all over the place, and they told you, you know, don't deal in drugs anymore. That's it. You're not going to deal in drugs anymore. If they've got surveillance cameras everywhere and they see everything you're doing, so you're not going to, well, here God is certainly surveillance. He sees everything that's going on. He creates everything. He knows everything that's happening. And God said, don't worship idols. That's what he said on Mount Sinai. First two commandments, everybody heard. Mipia Gabura. And everybody sure knew. And 40 days later, everybody participated either actively or passively in the golden calf. So it shows you how totally incomprehensible this whole business is, and it nevertheless it is. But what happened at the Mount Sinai? It's Mount Sinai when the Jewish people worshiped the golden calf. So it changed the whole nature. God said, "Oh, you think you can be the boss? You want to be God? You think you'll be on your own? Okay, you'll be on your own. Death. What does that mean? It means that God says, there'll be a time when, so to speak, I won't be with you. God is pure life. And when God is, so to speak, detached from a person, there's no life, there's death. It was supposed to be that people were supposed to live forever. People would feel God all the time. People would feel that every instant of life is brand new, fresh, miracle. It's a gift. It's a challenge. It's a responsibility. People were so happy to receive responsibility. There's nothing greater than having responsibility. And people said, "Who wants responsibility? What are we talking about? What responsibility? We want, We want to feel good. We want to feel good. We have this urge to worship idols, and we're going to go for it. So because of that, they separated themselves from the Creator. They separated themselves from the life. They brought death into the world. The golden calf brought death into the world. The red cow brings it back. Because just as incomprehensible is life and the opposite of life, as so is also the cure to the opposite of life, cure to death. At least the impurity of death is the red cow. But we learned about it in the Chumash class in the afternoon. They would look around all of Israel and find this cow that was totally red, that had no two black hairs, and had never worked. All these other very strange criteria that have absolutely nothing to do with curing and bringing a person out of impurity. Anyway, and when you find it, then you have to burn it, and you have to put it with water. You put the ashes in water and you sprinkle it on someone, and then that's it. That person becomes pure and he can go back into the temple. And if you don't do it, he can never go into the temple for the rest of his life. So he can never be attached to life. What was the temple? The temple was pure life, happiness. Okay. So let's go now. We're talking about, okay, so this is a big monumental thing over here. We're not talking about just a religious ritual for just the Jewish people. We're talking about changing the very fiber of reality. Is there death or is there not death? Right? Is living forever, is that boring or is it not? Wouldn't that be boring, living all the time, forever? Well, when Adam ate from the tree of bad and good, so he brought boredom into the world also. Before that, no one was bored. He wouldn't be bored. Every single was brand new, fresh. They say that one of the reasons that Adam ate from the tree was because he wanted to meet the challenge. God said, you can't eat from the tree. Don't do it. It's bad. And Adam said, I am in this world in order to fix up bad. There should not be any bad. The world, I am going to purify the world and eat the bad. That's what some people say. In any case, whatever it was, eating from this tree was a really bad choice. On the other hand, it's written in the Torah that Adam ate from the tree. And the Torah was written before the world. Mm-hmm. So somehow or other, in God's infinite essence wisdom, which is above ours, as this was, had to happen. You want to say it had to happen? These are things we cannot understand. But nevertheless, there it is. So also the healing is also there. So of course you're going to, I was preordained, people don't have free choice, come on, you know. And you got a point, it says, Nor alilot al b'nei Adam. It was a setup. But reality is reality. Here we are, we're not the boss, right? God is the boss, God is creating us. We're not creating anything. All we can do is wreck things up. You have a choice, either to wreck things up or do what God wants. Okay, so now the Rebbe is trying to explain, where does bad come from? Where does the potential of bad come from? Where does potential of bad come from? So this is a Kabbalistic idea, which is called klippa. Klippa are called shells, cells, the world of shells. Excuse me, a shell covers over the fruit, like dirt covers over a diamond or something, right? Diamonds are in the ground. If diamonds were just scattered all over the place, it wouldn't be valuable. Diamonds are hidden under the ground. The ground is like a shell. So it is the good in the world after Adam sinned. The good in the world is concealed inside of this shell. Before that, there was good and there was the shells. There was bad, but it was all in potential. You chose what you want. You choose what you want. That was called the tree of life. And as soon as Adam ate from the tree of good and bad, so he embodied both good and bad, and they became mixed up. You don't know what's good and what's bad. All of a sudden, what's bad seems good. What's good seems bad. Right? The worst thing, drugs seem like the best thing in the world. Right? Best thing, nothing better than taking drugs and, you know, wasting your life away, just having, you know, cheap thrills and see pleasures. Now they have this big thing in America, abortion, nothing better than abortion. We're willing to fight, willing to die, to kill our fetuses, kill that fetus. Why do you want to kill the fetus? Because they're responsible. What do you mean? Why? Because they're responsibility. It's a burden to us. No, so anyone is a burden to you, you can kill them. Okay, not that, but the fetus is not really a human being. And if we can convince you that it is a human being, then you won't kill him. We want against the whole thing is life precious or is it not precious? That's the question. There's responsibility. With life, there's responsibility. There's problems, right? It's like the joke they say, the guy said, I found the solution to old age. What, how? Hang yourself. There's the anger that you want to live to an old age. That's the solution. Okay. So here we have the klippas. We have the forces of potential death and various forms of death in the world. That's called klippa. It covers over life. It covers over good. But there's one type of a shell which we are here in the world to fix up. And that's what's called shell, shining shell. Klippat noga, a shell which is noga, shines. Shining shell. Sheyesh bo gam ken, that it also has... Hey Gvuros. It also has these five aspects of severity, which are Gvurot Kashot, five aspects of severity, hard severity. Now, severity is a good thing. For instance, blood. Blood is red, that shows on severity. It's warm, that shows on severity, but it keeps you alive. Blood is a good thing. But if it's on the wrong place, then it's not good. If a person has a cut and the blood falls out, it has to go through the veins. That's why there's 365 veins. And those are directing life. 365 corresponding to the 365 negative commandments. Okay, so Nasa, this is what's called Klipat Noga. This is called the power of God's, they say, there's a word for it. Neutral creation. Now, neutral is not good. Everything is supposed to be godliness. The whole world is supposed to, can't remain neutral. Right? Like those countries that remain neutral in World War II. Now, what's Switzerland? They're neutral. What does it mean, neutral? We're not helping the Germans and we're not opposing the Germans. We're neutral. Is that good? Well, I mean, it's better than being the Nazis, right? Yeah, but it's like sort of half Nazis. It's all like all the art and treasures are there and they wouldn't let Jews in. And neutral. We didn't do anything bad. We're not killing anybody. That's like Klipat Noga. Klipat Noga, it's neutral shells. Shells. Shenase bechinat hitchalkut. And there is the ability, God's, how do you say, tendency to divide. That is what's called the world of separation, right? The physical world, neutral. The world doesn't shine God, and it doesn't shine any evil, death, murder, but you don't shine God, that's already bad. That's already a potential for bad. But on the other hand, there's a potential for good also. Convinced either way. So that's the world, the natural world that you can use, that's Klipat Noga. All the things that you can use to do Torah and the commandments, Masha Enkin, which is not the case, Lamaila, above, in the upper worlds, right, heavens, whatever, the angels are Hagam, even though there's also division up there, Madregos, there's also infinite numbers of divisions and levels of spirituality. And at each level, each dimension of spirituality, there's infinite aspects of, it is like, the permutations and combinations of angels and different creations in these upper worlds, mikomakom, nevertheless. Kaven she'en bebechin is bitul. But since in the upper worlds, it's true there's all this diversity in the upper worlds as well. But in the upper worlds, in the heavens, they have something we don't have. And that's what's called harmony. Surrender. Right? Like in an orchestra. Ever see there's these, whatever these orchestras come, not that I'm a big understander, there's this composition of Mahler, he's got like the orchestra is 500 pieces and the choir is 500 people and this 1,000 people. When it starts, you figure this is going to be a catastrophe, right? At least they're all dressed the same. But it's going to be, they start to play, it's beautiful. It's just amazing. And if it would have been, you know, not 1,000 people, 500 people, it'd be a little bit less beautiful. If it was 10 people, it'd be a little bit less. The same thing. In this physical world, there's all this division, but it's a catastrophe. There's no harmony whatsoever. That's why God put us in the world in order to harmonize the world, make it surrendered to the unity. But in the upper worlds, they're already surrendered. You don't have to have Jews up in the upper world fixing and doing commandments and things like that, because the upper worlds are already surrendered. Like it says, Tzva Shemayim, the hosts of the heaven, they bow down to you, God. So they're all unified, right? Like the orchestra is unified with the music. All these angels and whatever it is, the different levels of angels, different worlds. So they're all different, and they're all, there's the angel Michoel, and he's got all these camps under him, and right from the side of kindness and from the side of power, in front of this infinite, infinite diversity of angels and spiritual powers that they are. But all of them feel that they're being created. Now, why is God creating all these things? I don't know. If it was up to me, I wouldn't create them. And so you're very lucky that I'm not God. Because if I was, I probably wouldn't even create myself. But God is creating all these worlds, including all the worlds that rebel against him, this physical world. God is creating all this, an infinite... Every individual world is infinite. Okay, note like it says, that's Ayin Nefesh, Yotzei Yerech Yaakov. That's the whole idea of the 70 souls that came from the loins of Jacob. That went down to Egypt, right? That's the Jewish people that went down to Egypt. There were only 70. She'av Shem Ayin, even though there are only 70, Mikomakom, nevertheless, Ne'amar Behenet says, Nefesh. It says, soul, says the 70 soul, doesn't say souls. The Jewish people, when they came down into Egypt, they were unified because they had bittul. They all were surrendered to the one God of Jacob. Jacob taught everybody that there's a creator and that the creator gives us responsibility and that we should tune in to the fact that we're being created and there's a creator and that we're given responsibility and that there's a king that gives us responsibility. They really felt this. Masha'enkin v'noga, which is not the case, what's called klipat noga, the regular nature of the world, hu b'chinat pirud, it's all separate, bishalkos and division. Right? How many bugs are there? How many atoms are there? How many planets are there? How many galaxies are there? How many different types of energy? Lefi, because... Yesh, because the whole thing of the creation is that it's what's called yesh. Yesh means separateness. I'm skipping on this. This is all the footnote by the Tzemach Tzedek, the third Rebbe of Chabad, which is very interesting, but this can be read without it, and let's do it. Zeo, that's what it means, called Ikarinyan, Bechinas Noga. That's the whole idea of the creation. Noga means we got shining shells. The world that has a potential to go either way, bad or good. But that, because it just has a potential, it's neutral. So that in the Tanya is called bad. That's called a very high level of bad, because good is only what reveals God. What reveals God? And what is reveals God is what does God's will. Things that do God's will, that's revealing God. Things that don't do God's will, they're not doing God's will, according to the Torah, that's not godly. Nature, it's nature. So a cat and a dog and a tree and the sun and the moon, and all these things are neutral, and neutral is bad. Neutral is bad. It's a very high type of bad, because we're changing the whole definition of what is good and bad. Good means anything that reveals God. Bad is anything that doesn't. Now, we're not talking about a bad that you go to hell for or whatever. A person is a natural person. Let's see, does all the commandments and he learns the Torah because he likes it. He's a Jewish person and he likes it and he does it. So that's good, right? Is that good? This is no. If he does it only for selfish reasons, that's called bad. But the guy is going to go to heaven. He'll go to heaven. He'll get all the rewards. But still, as far as serving God goes, that's called bad. That's the Tanya. The Tanya does. And this level is called klipat noga, nature. It's not like the three impure klipot, the three impure shells. Three impure shells, these are urges to do bad. Urges to go against the Torah. Murder, idolatry, licentiousness. Shame ra gamor, this is totally bad. That's a war against God. Hagam, even though shenoga, that nature, let's, noga means the shining level, this clip of noga, let's call it nature. Nature is also half bad, right? That's the tree of bad and good. Nature, hainu, neutral. Neutral means you can go either way. Hainu, chetzia, it's half bad, but it's also half good. It has the potential to be good. Afopikin, nevertheless, Kam Tovshaba, also the good, which is in it, is also called Klipat Noga. It's also called shining shell, the good, which is in nature. Hainu lefi shehu bebechinas yesh, but it's because it's separate. Ukomo bishvil shikra eni rav. Like I said before, a person does the Torah, he learns Torah, does all the commandments, but he does it because it's his nature, or because he does it in order that he should be called rabbi. But rabbi has to put on tefillin. The rabbi has to be a good example. And also, rabbi also gets a nice, you know, paycheck at the end of the month. And he gets also attention from his congregation, and he has a bit of power, and he has a bit of popularity. So he does the commandments. Right? Doing the commandments is good. He says, but nevertheless, he's doing the commandments, true, but he's not really doing it to reveal God. He's doing it because everybody has to do something, right? So, you know, there's no need. Doctors is already filled. Lawyers is already filled. And he doesn't want to be a doctor. He gets his hands dirty with blood and things like that. And the lawyer people yell at you. He becomes a rabbi. The rabbi, he gets honor from the congregation. He can stand up and give sermons, right? He feels meaningful. He makes that impression to his wife, his children. He's got it in his doors written, rabbi. Rabbi, even on his house, written rabbi. So it's okay. You know, that's all right. That's all right. Says, but all right is not exactly the point why the world was created. The thing should be what they call all right, because all right is not all right, it's half right. Half right. All right means that you reveal God. That you're doing things because God wants you to. You don't care about receiving rewards, not in this world, not in the world to come. Like Abraham, that's Judaism. That's what's called selfishness. That's called noga, nature. He does it because this is nature. His nature, he wants to be a rabbi. He's a spiritual person. If he has a nature to be religious, there's people that are like that. They like religion. They like religious things. They like religious ideas. They want to be part of a group. They don't like the world so much. Masha'inkin, which is not the case, but Kedusha in the level of holiness, who bechinas bitul. This is the level of total surrender. The lochin, therefore, surrender to God, harmony with God. Lochin, therefore, all you bechinas klipas noga. Therefore, through what's called nature, right, through this neutral level of creation, klipat noga, mekablim gimel klipat atmeyot, the three impure klipot can receive. Huh? Like the famous, you know, stories of the, here you have Stalin. Stalin was killing people right and left, millions of people, but he posed as a nice guy. He was just a leader. He has a family. He has children, right? He has a very difficult situation. The Germans are attacking or whatever it is, right? And he's got his problem, but he wanted to be a nice guy. So he presented himself to be a nice guy. And it was very convincing. You have all these famous, you know, mafia guys that they have families and they care about their parents and they're murderers. Because that's nature. Nature can cover over. Nature is a, how do you say, a go-between, a connector between good and bad. So you can take good and pull it down into bad. being a family man, being a church going, a law abiding citizen, and that can draw energy into being bad. Like they say, a lie, if it hasn't got some truth to it, it's not believed. The more truth that there is in a lie, the better the lie works. The better it works. So that's the idea of nature, klipos tameos. That's called the bad side of the world. That's evil. Then there's godliness. That's good. And in between, there's what's called nature. And nature is what I call it, a high level of bad. Ki klipot noga, because this level of nature, klipot noga, shining shells, chetzia tov, half of it is good and half of it is bad. Shev chetzia tov, that the half that's good, mekabel gam chetzia ra, that from the good part, the bad part receives. Umechetzia ra, and from the good, from the bad part of klipot noga, that's where the three impure klipot, where all the evil things also receive. So if a Jew decides he wants to be, let's say, a normal person, he's not going to do any sins, he's not going to do any, right? He's not going to do any of this. But from that, just to be neutral, can come all sorts of things which are against the Torah, right? You can marry a non-Jew. What's wrong with marrying a non-Jew? It's the most normal thing in the world, right? You have children, you have a nice family, but it's against the Torah. That's against what God wants. And God is creating us. So who would dream, right? That you can, even more, you're going to have the person, he's a big rabbi, but he beats his wife. But he's a rabbi, he's a big shot, right? He can, they say, the cheat, he can lie. Right, you have priests, they extort the people who get money, you have to give me money for this and money for that. But the things that are going on in the church, they find these things with these priests doing with their children. What's going on? What does it mean? Because the outside, the veneer of being orderly and being godly, whatever, if it's not true, then that can become a go-between to pull good into bad. That's what it means. That's klipos noga. That's nature. Nature is half bad, half good. What does it mean, half good? Who hergesh is the yesh? The half good that is in nature is you feel yourself. It's not holiness. But nevertheless, this go-between can be refined, and it can surrender itself totally to the infinite light of God. Like it says, the angels in heaven. Now the angels in heaven, that's part of klipat noga. That's part of nature. But these angels have a nature to them that the bad is not so strong. The good is strong. They feel God. And that's why they're crying out to God. So they have their individual egos, if you want to call it. But on the other hand, it's dominated by their feeling of God. So that's why is the Rebbe going into this explanation? He's going in to try to explain to us what the dynamics of reality, according to the Torah. According to the Torah, the dynamics of reality is that there's not just a world. There's not just a world. But there's a creator. World is the spiritual, the physical, the angels, that's world. So it comes out there's, so to speak, three levels. There's the creator, there's the world, and then there's evil. Or let's say creator, nature, and evil. And nature can go either way. Nature can even more, it can take from holiness, life, and pull it down into evil. This is it. Depends who we're taking an example from. We can take an example from the angels. That's why in our prayers in the morning, we have this whole big section talking about the angels, and how the angels are all saying holy, holy, and holy. Because we want to take an example from the angels. From the angels, we can learn that God is really real, and he's really exciting, and there's what to get excited about. And that God is really, really, how I say, infinitely powerful and infinitely good. And even more, God is creating us. We don't feel it at all, but the angels do. And the angels, they know what they're getting excited about. So we get excited like the angels. We take our yesh, our egotism, and we can use it like the angels do and get excited about God. But The fact is, we're in the world, in the physical world. And that's why sometimes, Bechinat Noga or the Lagamri, that we can sometimes elevate this physical world to holiness. Here he brings all sorts of Kabbalistic books and things like that. The parentheses, let's go where it ends. Oh, that's what I mean. Zinyan. Sreifas Apara. Let's go back. Then now we're talking about the burning of the cow. Kedei, in order to avir at Ruach Hatuma, in order to get rid of the spirit of impurity. So what do we say? That there's God, godliness, there's nature, and then there's evil. God creates nature, and he creates the potential for evil, but we're the ones that make the choice to go into evil or not. God give us free will. So if the person makes the choice to go into evil like they did with the golden calf, so that brings death into the world. How do we get rid of this death? You can't. It's impossible. You can never go into the Holy Temple the rest of your life unless your only hope is the red cow. You have to find the red cow, slaughter it, and take it outside of the slaughter. The whole thing is outside of the Holy Temple. Take it way far away for the Holy Temple. You can't do it. Don't do it. It has to be done by a Kohen. It has to be done a special way. In Jerusalem, etc. You burn the cow. You take the ashes. Store up the ashes. As soon as someone gets impure, touches a dead body, is in the same room as a dead body, a dead body goes over him. He passes over a dead body, even if it's buried. Then he becomes impure, can never go into the Holy Temple again until he gets the ashes of the red cow. And the ashes of the red cow, he puts it into water, the ashes, and then he has it sprinkled on him. And if one little drop falls on him, that's it, it's pure. That's the whole idea. Now we're going to explain it. Remember what the question we had before? That putting the ashes on the water, a woman can do, but a child can't. But spraying the mixture on the impure person, a child can do, but a woman can't. Why? We'll see. Let's see. We'll get to that. I don't know if we'll get to it today, but just to remind you what the question was. That's the whole idea of the burning of this para, of the cow. Kadei, in order to have your ruach hatuma, in order to get rid of the spirit of impurity, the spirit of death, which is settled on a person because he touched a dead body or he was key, because para, this para, this cow, who is bechinat noga, that represents what we call nature. Shapara u bechinat nukva, shemakabam bechinat pnei shor. That para, this, they call it a heifer, red heifer. The cow, this cow, this is feminine, nukva means feminine, and it receives from the face of the ox. Huh? What's the face of the ox? Well, if you look in the prophecy of Ezekiel, so it says that he saw this big vision of the heavens. He saw that there was God sitting on a chariot. God, as they say, is the world of Atzilut, this level. And he was sitting on the chariot. The chariot is the world of below that. That's the world of Bria. And there were on this chariot or the throne, there were four faces. There was four faces. There was a face of a ox, the face of a man, the face of a lion, and the face of an eagle. And the dominant one of all of them is the face of the ox. So it says, from this face of the ox comes all of the kosher animals in the world, all the animals in the world, however, all the kosher animals in the world come from this ox. And also comes the animal soul, the Jews. Okay. Nevertheless, these faces are things that are in this world, but in their source, where they come from. That's what he saw. So the cow, this red cow, is the feminine aspect, cow is feminine, receives from the ox, which is masculine, up there in the world of Bria, in the source. Ella Shehiba Bechinas Gevuros Kashot. But the ox, as it is in the upper worlds, is the source of creation, right? Source of creation. This is Gevura, like life, right? Like blood is life. This is Ashur. This is the power of life, power that comes into the world that creates all these animals. But in this world, if it gets too severe, namely death, death is like very severe, right? That's like a ultimate limit. If there is death in the world, how do you get rid of it? By para. This is what's called even more severity. Par hey. Remember we said par is the numerical value of mansapach, the end letters, and the hey we said are the five organs of God's speech. How God limits himself through the letters in order to come down and make this nature, like we said before. Umimena, that's the para. Para is nature. From it, this para, which represents nature, we said it's possible for the three impure klipot to receive. So para, the cow, that represents nature. And from this nature, it's, right, this aspect of God's nature, klipot noga. From it, even though it's neutral, but all the powers of evil can receive. So what do we do with this nature, which is represented by the cow? Sraf, we have to burn it. You burn up the power, cow, and you make ashes. Omer Azal Rash, rabbis say, Eshkechan, Afer, the Ikri Afar. Sometimes ashes are called dirt. In this week's Torah portion, you'll see it alternates between the word afer, which is ashes, and afar, which is dirt. Vehine, we call davar everything that's burned. Right? So we take this para, which represents nature, and which is the go-between good and bad. It itself is not bad, but half bad. It's the connector between good and bad, the middleman, the nature, or the cow, is the middleman between good and bad, and you burn it. When you burn it, it becomes ashes. Hainu, the fish are called davar, because everything in the world that's in nature is composed of four elements: fire, wind, water, and earth. The Ikari Sabos, the main physicality of the physical world, is from earth. Right? When a person dies, they put them in the earth. The body is made of earth, even though there's 90% water, whatever it is. But nevertheless, the physicality that you actually see of a person, that's the earth. Well, when you reduce it, if you burn it and remove the water and the air, and of course the fire removes all the heat. So all that's left is dirt. Why? Because the dirt, earth holds, is the basis which holds on to the other three elements: fire, air, and water. Remove the fire, air, and water, and what do you have left? Only the earth. Look, and therefore they serve by means of burning this cow, which we said cow is, represents all of nature, all of creation, neutral, by means of burning this, mispardim, yisodos, then there is separated. These elements that compose it, benisha, rak yisoda, atzmi, there's remain only its very essence, which is dirt. Dirt is the foundation of this cow. And the other things are added on to it just to give it a shape and a form, whatever. The kahu inyan srefa zapara, this is the whole idea of burning the cow. not to destroy nature, but to bring nature down to its lowest common denominator, name of the ashes. Only the source of God's creative force, God's speech, and the source of it, and that's still connected to the Creator. That's the ashes. The ashes of it that represents the, I say, the point, the essential being of the thing, that's bittul. Ashes and dirt is the good part of the world, namely humility. King David said, may my soul be like dirt to everyone. We say it in davening also. Mazeo, that's what afer is. What do we say? Para. Para, we said, is the mansapach with a hay. Afer is also par, mansapach, but with an aleph. Afer is ashes. You take the para and take the hay and make it into an aleph. What does that mean? Par aleph. Hainu hagvuros, namely the severities, as they are in their source, like in the face of the ox, we said, up in the upper heavens. There it's holy. The cow comes into the world, namely nature comes into the world from the face of the ox, which is holiness. But as it comes into the world, so it has all these other elements added to it, and it seems to be a separate entity into itself. That's the para. But when you burn it, so all the other elements go away, and is left only the very essence of the existence of this thing, which is godliness. That's like it was when it was in the face of the ox on the chariot. Kodem shenimshach b'chinas yesh, before it came into the physical world by means of the hegavuras of Noga, we said by means of these para with the hay, that was the five severities that make spirituality into being physical, make holiness into being neutral. So burning the ox, just burning it, that's already reducing nature to its basic foundation, which is holiness. It's a creation. God is creating it. So by looking at the creation and realizing that it's all just part of the Creator, and the Creator is creating it, so all of the enticements of the world, which can bring us into selfishness and bad, they just aren't relevant to us. Right? Aren't relevant to us. It's given the example in Mishlei that the prostitute, she dresses herself up, puts on perfume, and she seems to look really beautiful, and she calls the people, come, we'll have a good time. And it seems to be very enticing, you know, very enticing to the person. But a person that's really loyal, and he understands what's going on, and he understands that this is just a test, so it doesn't pay any attention to him. He doesn't notice the lipstick and not the perfume and not the this and not the calling, and doesn't notice anything. Exactly the opposite. He could say a good word, you know, God bless you, you know, may you be well, may you have money without having to degrade yourself. Say something nice. Who knows? Because if you reduce things down to their basic essence, what they are, then all of a sudden everything becomes a different situation. Everything becomes a miracle. And that's the whole idea of burning the para. Para represents nature. Para represents the neutral world, not holy and not unholy. But because of it's not holy, so therefore it's also, it can be easily convinced to be a conduit to unholy. That's para, that's the world, that's creation. God wants it to be that way. If things get out of hand, so what do we have to do? We have to reduce nature to its basic element. That's what it means, burning the para, to reduce it down to earth, its basic connection to the Creator of the universe. That's only step number one, burning it. Step number two is we have to put the ashes on the water. Step number three is we have to sprinkle the water. Putting the ashes on the water can be done by a woman and not a child. Child can't do it. Sprinkling it can be done by a child, but not by a woman. Why? Tune in tomorrow and find out. Now we're going to learn the Devar Malchut.